Hi everyone. I hope you guys are doing well this week and you had a good Sunday with your families. I'm back again with another book for us to read. This time I have a new one for you for a different country. Our book today is going to be called Missing in Madagascar. This book is cool because it talks about a missionary kid who's learning about what it's like to live in a new country for the first time. So let's take a look at this first real quick. I've got a map over here so we can figure out where Madagascar is. We love this book. Isn't that neat? This is the book, Our World. And here, if you look at the country of Africa, Madagascar is right here. And even cooler, check this guy out right here. This is a lemur, and a lemur will be part of our story today, okay? So I'm gonna have it sitting over here on the pillow so you guys can still look at it. All right, let's go ahead and get started. Missing in Madagascar. Chapter 1. Big Red. Look at that red dirt, Jeff exclaimed, peering out the window at the 737 jet. That's why it's called the Red Island, his dad explained as he pulled a map from the seat pocket in front of them. Madagascar is the fourth largest island in the world. Where is it located? Asked Jeff. It's located off the coast of Africa. Take a look at this. Jeff's dad opened the map and pointed to the middle of the big island. There's Tana, the city where we'll live. I'm glad you and Mom are missionaries, Jeff said. That makes Julie and me missionary kids. I like being an MK. I remember how excited you were when we told you about our move to Madagascar, said Dad. That's because lemurs and other really cool animals and plants live there. I read about them on the internet. I can't wait to find lemurs. You remember our lemur? He's right down here. And Madagascar is right here. Julie was not as excited. She sat across the aisle next to her mother, looking sad. Julie did not want to move to Madagascar. She was 13 and had a hard time leaving her friends behind. Of course, 10-year-old Jeff left friends too, but the hardest part for him was leaving his dog Jake at his grandparents' house. Although they promised to take good care of Jake, Jeff had said goodbye with tears spilling down his cheeks. Dad, I miss Jake. I know I'll get to see him when we go home on furlough, but I still miss him. I know, maybe we can get another dog, Jeff's dad suggested. We'll need a guard dog in Tana. Just then, the pilot announced, please fasten your seatbelts. We'll be landing in a few minutes. Thank you for flying Air Madagascar. As soon as the plane landed, the family had their passports stamped and picked up their luggage. Suddenly, they found themselves facing strangers who were holding out hands trying to grab their suitcases. What do they want? Jeff asked. He could not understand their language. They want to earn money by carrying our suitcases, Dad said, as he hurried his family toward the gate. When we learn to speak Malagasy, we can communicate with them. Julie frowned. How will we learn Malagasy? It won't take long for you to learn, Dad smiled. We'll take classes and we'll make friends too. Before you know it, you'll be able to speak the language and feel at home here. There's our ride, Mom pointed toward a smiling, brown-skinned young man. He was holding a sign with their name on it. Welcome to Madagascar. My name is Frederic. I'm your guard and driver. I'll take you to your home. The young man shook hands and led them to an old blue Land Rover in the airport parking lot. I'm glad he speaks English, Jeff thought. I want to ask him about lemurs. Frederic helped the family load their suitcases into the Land Rover, and then they climbed in and sat down. Frederic drove from one side of the road to the other to avoid huge potholes big enough to swallow a car. Those are big potholes. Crowds of people walked in the road along with strange-looking, humpback animals with long horns. Are those cows? Jeff asked. They look different than the cows in America. No, they are zebu. Frederic replied as he jerked the steering wheel to avoid hitting one. The people here actually worship them. Where are the lemurs? Jeff asked. I can't wait to see the coolest monkeys in the world. Frederic drove around another pothole before he answered. You probably won't see many lemurs here in the city. Most of them live in the rainforests. Look at those people selling food by the side of the road, Julie exclaimed. Meat hung from hooks. Loaves of bread sat on tables. Vegetables and fruit lay on cardboard on the ground. Smoke from charcoal burners smelled like barbecued meat. We're here, Frederick said as he turned a corner and drove onto a dirt road. He pulled up to a locked gate and tooted the horn. Now let's take a look at this. See some of the pictures that you see? There's Land River. Look at the big potholes. There's the Cebu. There's people carrying food and walking along the road. Looks a little bit different than what we have here in America, huh? Let's continue. A boy opened up the gate. That's my son, Pascal. My wife and I and our children live in the little brick building next to the gate. Jeff cannot believe what he saw next. So before we continue, there were a couple words that you may have questions about. One of those words was when Jake said, I know I'll get to see him when we go home on furlough, but I still miss him. Furlough is like a break that people get to take when they're missionaries, meaning they spend all of their time basically in one country, and then they get to go home on furlough. During that time period, they visit other churches in America, in their community. That's where they share about their experiences, and they can also fundraise during that time to earn money to take back with them to serve the people that they have. Okay? And then the next one, let's see. You guys got to see the lemurs. Oh, here's a picture. They were talking about food markets. See this right here? For us, probably the closest thing that we would understand of what this is probably like a summer's market or a farmer's market that we have here in downtown Rapid City. A lot of busier, bigger places have markets like this. A lot of countries in other parts of the world have markets like this where people just set their food out and sell them. That's where they go grocery shopping. They get the things that they need. Okay, you guys ready for chapter two? Chapter two, Rhoda. A big brown dog raced toward the car. Yes, Jeff shouted. That dog looks a lot like Jake. Now, I really like being an MK here. What's the dog's name? Her name is Rhoda, Frederick said as he drove up the long driveway to a big white house. Trees shaded the yard and flowers bloomed in the sunshine. Jeff jumped out of the Land Rover and looked back toward the gate, hoping to see a lemur. Instead, he saw children's brown faces peering underneath it. Look! Mom, Dad, Julie! Jeff pointed to the gate. Those kids are watching us. They're the reason we're here, Mom said. That's right. God wants us to tell them about Jesus and his love, Dad added. Just then, the dog ran from behind the car. Come here, Rhoda! Jeff held out his hand. Be careful, Frederick warned. She's a guard dog. Give her time to get to know you. I'll see you later, Rhoda. Come on, Julie, Jeff called. Let's check out the house. Wow, look at all the boxes. Why are they stacked in here? Everywhere Jeff looked, he saw apple boxes and banana boxes. A narrow path through the boxes led to the kitchen. Another trail opened into the bathroom. Dad chuckled. These boxes are filled with clothes. People in America sent the clothing for children at the Nazarene Street Kids Corner. You and Julie can help Mom and me take it to them. I read about the street kids in one of our mission books, Julie said. Kids go to the center to learn and get food and medical care. They don't have families to care for them. That's why our family gives $20 each month to sponsor Buna, a boy who goes to the center, Mom explained. The money helps the center provide for some of Buna's needs, such as food. That's important, Dad said. It might be the only food he gets to eat that day. I hope I can meet Buna, Jeff said. Here they are at their house. Just meet the dog and explore his new space. After Julie and Dad looked through the house, Julie felt relieved. Dad, maybe it won't be so bad here after all. Mom said we could each choose our own bedroom, but it seems funny to have bars on the windows. The people here are very poor, and some of them steal, Dad explained. That's why we have a guard, a wall around the yard, and bars on the windows. After Julie and Jeff chose their rooms, Jeff decided to explore the yard. As he followed the high wall around the property, he noticed broken glass had been built into the top of the wall. I wouldn't want to climb over that, he thought. Jeff looked into every tree in the yard, still trying to find a lemur. But he only saw bananas and mangoes, which is still pretty cool, seeing how he has bananas and mangoes in his yard. Frederick's children and their dog, Rhoda, followed Jeff around the yard. At first, the dog kept her distance from Jeff. Finally, she got close enough to sniff Jeff's outstretched hand. I think we'll be friends, Jeff said. I miss Jake, but I'm glad you're here. Jeff was still exploring the yard when he heard a scream. That sounds like Julie, he thought. He ran back to the house. Help! The scream came from Julie's bedroom. Jeff hurried to Julie's room and found her standing on a chair. Help! Julie screamed again. A huge green and yellow lizard about a foot long stared up at her. Jeff laughed when he saw it. That's just a chameleon, he said. I read about them before we came. There are more chameleons here than anywhere in the world. It won't hurt you. Well, then take it to your room, exclaimed Julie. Just get it out of here. I'll send it outside, Jeff said, shooing the chameleon out of her room. That night, Jeff prayed and thanked God for bringing his family to Madagascar. He asked God to watch over Jake and his family and friends in America. Then he prayed for Buna. A few days later, Dad asked Frederick to take them to the Street Kids Center. We can take the boxes of clothing, Dad said. Great, exclaimed Jeff. I can meet Buna. Jeff had another idea, too. Here you go. What would you do if you saw a chameleon inside your house? I think I would probably do the same thing that Julie did, don't you? All right, chapter 3, Lost in the Rainforest. I really want to find some lemurs, Jeff said. Could Frederick also take us to the rainforest? First, I want to meet the teachers of the Street Kids Center, Dad said. Then we'll go to the rainforest. Can we take Buna along with us to the rainforest? Jeff asked. We'll ask his teacher if he can come, replied Mom. You know he probably doesn't speak English, and we don't know Malagasy yet. That's okay. Maybe he can help us learn a few words. When the family arrived at the Street Kids Center, they saw several hundred kids sitting at long tables. They were eating bowls of rice and drinking milk. Many of them wore ragged clothes. Now I see why we brought all those boxes filled with clothes, Jeff said. Mom and Dad talked to the teachers, the cooks, and their helpers. One of the teachers introduced them to Buna. She told him they were the ones who made it possible for him to come to the Street Kids Center. A big smile spread across Buna's face. Then Dad asked if Buna could go with them to the rainforest. When Buna's teacher asked him if he would like to go with them, he smiled again. All three children ran outside and jumped into the Land Rover. Buna sat down between Julie and Jeff. My name is Jeff, he said, pointing to himself. Jeff. Jiff, repeated Buna, pointing at Jeff. Buna laughed and pointed at himself. Buna. Jeff giggled. Well, at least we're running our names. Jeff reached over to give Buna a high-five hand slap. Buna looked surprised, raised his hand, and then returned the slap. He learns fast, Jeff said. 3 hours later, they reached the rainforest. Frederick parked the Land Rover. He offered to wait while the others followed a trail into the forest. So here's the kids at the center that they were talking about. We have different types of shelters, just like this, too. This is a children's center, and if you notice, they were eating rice and milk. Rice is very common for a lot of cultures around the world. It is often a staple, which means they use it all the time in all of their meals and cooking. Oftentimes, rice is primary in both breakfast, lunch, and dinner. So they eat a lot of rice. But the cool thing about a center like this means that these kids get to go here, they get to have a meal. They get to have clothes. They have people who love them and care about them, and they're also telling them about Jesus. Let's see what happens at the rainforest. Huge trees with overhanging branches made the trail look like a tunnel. Jeff looked and looked, but he did not see a lemur anywhere. While Mom, Dad, and Julie were trying to talk with Buna, Jeff ran ahead to see if he could find some lemurs on his own. He found a side trail that looked interesting and decided to follow it. At last, Jeff saw lemurs leaping from a tree to tree. They moved so fast he could hardly keep up with them. Before he knew it, they were leading him off the trail and deeper into their forest. Jeff saw their pointy noses, big eyes, and black and white striped tails. But as soon as the lemurs saw him, they quickly scrambled higher into the trees. Suddenly, Jeff realized he was alone and could no longer see the trail. Uh-oh. He remembered what his dad said to do if he ever got lost. Stay where you are. Jeff looked around. The lemurs were gone. He listened for voices. Birds screeched and insects buzzed, but he could not hear any voices. Clouds of mosquitoes swarmed around him. He swatted bugs and wiped the sweat off his face and neck. When will my parents miss me? Jeff wondered. Will they find me? What if I have to stay in the rainforest all night? Many questions ran through his mind. Jeff started yelling, Dad! Mom! Help! I'm lost! His voice echoed through the trees. He yelled again, Help! He heard nothing except the buzzing of insects. I have to get away from these bugs, screamed Jeff. He started running, but suddenly he felt something grabbing his legs. Uh-oh. Chapter 4. Rescued. Jeff struggled to get away from whatever was holding him. The more he struggled, the tighter the hold on his legs became. He could not stand any longer. When he fell to the ground, he saw the problem. Vines were tangled around his legs. What do I do now? Jeff moaned. I'm glad there are no poisonous snakes in Madagascar. Just then, he heard someone yelling. Jeff! A voice yelled. Buna! Jeff shouted. Help! I'm over here! Buna came running through the trees, pushing his way through the brush. When he reached Jeff, he untangled the vines from around his legs and motioned for him to follow. Buna led Jeff back to the side trail. When they reached the main trail, Dad, Mom, and Julie were waiting. They all hugged. Mom had tears in her eyes. Don't ever scare us like that again, she scolded. Here he is. Thank you, Buna. It's a blessing, isn't it? Thank the Lord Buna found you, Dad said. How did he know where to look? Jeff asked. A big smile covered Buna's shiny brown face. He's a smart young man, Dad said. He probably has a good sense of direction from living on the street. Jeff gave Buna a high-five sign and gently punched his shoulder. Thanks, friend. I'm sure glad we brought you along. Jeff knew Buna did not understand the words, but Jeff could tell by the smile on his face. Buna knew what he meant. Jeff stayed close to the others as they walked through the rainforest. He had done enough exploring for one day. Just the thought of spending a night alone in the forest was enough to keep him on the main trail. As Jeff, his family, and Buna hiked beside the river, they saw lemurs and chameleons. Prickly, guinea pig-like animals, small enough to fit in your hand, rolled themselves into balls for protection. Beautiful flowers and trees grew along the trail. Let's head back to the Land Rover, Dad instructed. It's getting dark. It's been a good day, Jeff thought, even though I got lost. I found some lemurs, and I made a new friend. Before leaving Buna at the Street Kids Center, Jeff tried one of the new Malagasy words he had learned. Veluma, which means goodbye. Veluma, Buna. Buna smiled and gave Jeff a high five. Buna had learned something new, too. All right, our last chapter, Chapter 5. Jeff's friend. How would you like to visit the marketplace? Dad asked one morning. What's at the marketplace? Asked Jeff. Everything from sunglasses, straw hats, and soap to vegetables, fruit, and rice, said Dad. There's a lot of rice, added Mom. People eat it at every meal in Madagascar. Where is the market? Asked Julie. It's downtown, answered Dad. Most of the street kids hang out there. And at night, many of them sleep in the streets near the market. After breakfast, Frederick drove the family into the city. I'll stay in the Land Rover and wait, said Frederick. Watch out for pickpockets, he warned. Those are people that like to steal from your pockets. So if they think that you're unsuspecting or they bump up against you, they try to take your money out of your pocket or your purse. It's especially common in big public places anywhere in the world. And if people think that you're tourist or you're new, they usually try to go for you first. That's why he warned them. Jeff followed his parents and Julie as they walked through the crowd. They saw hundreds of booths where merchants sold their goods. Kids darted here and there. Some hid behind the booths, and others begged for food. I wish I could help them, Jeff thought. As he leaned over to look at some baskets stacked high on a table, he saw a bed made out of cardboard beneath the booth. Wow, a street kid must sleep here, Jeff said out loud. Dad, can we buy food and give it to that street kid? Jeff asked. He suddenly realized his dad was gone. And his mom and Julie were gone too. Jeff looked around in every direction as people pushed past him. His family had disappeared. Jeff's heart began to beat faster. Everyone around him was talking in a language he could not understand. He became confused. Jeff! A voice yelled. Jeff turned around, and there was his new friend, Buna. He gave Jeff a high five and motioned for Jeff to follow him. Buna led Jeff past tables of pottery, baskets, vegetables, and meat. Finally, they came to the Land Rover. Jeff's parents and his sister were talking to Frederick. They looked relieved when they saw the boys. Mom hugged Jeff. Where have you been? We've been looking everywhere for you. All of a sudden, you were gone, explained Jeff. Buna helped me find you. He led me here. Jeff's dad decided to turn a problem into a learning experience. Jeff, you've been lost twice since we arrived in Madagascar. How does it feel to be lost? Jeff thought a moment. It feels awful to be lost, Dad. It's about the worst thing that's happened to me. He thought again for another moment, then added, without Jesus, people here are lost too. We need to help them, sort of like Buna helped me. Right, replied Dad. God helped Buna find you when you were lost. What can you do to help those who need Jesus? First, I need to learn their language so I can tell them about Jesus, answered Jeff. I can pray for them too. I can try to earn money to give to other missionaries so they can tell people about Jesus. And I can be a friend to Buna. Jeff reached toward Buna. Thanks, Buna, for being my friend. Buna smiled and held up his hands. The friends exchanged high fives. I'll make sure Buna knows about Jesus, too, Jeff said. And here's a picture of them together. Well, that was a pretty cool book, guys. It's kind of fun learning about a different place from the perspective of somebody that's not been there before. It's true. A lot of kids get to travel with their families when they're missionaries, and missionaries can go anywhere in the world and be there and get to know the culture and the people there. They become their family. They learn about Jesus through them. And because of that, their communities, their families, and their friends get to know about Jesus as well. And then the missionaries get to come home every once in a while so they can tell others about what they're doing in the work, what they may need there, what people can pray for them for. And it kind of just goes round and round. It's just something really cool to think about that we have a family of God no matter where we are. And that is just a huge blessing. God made us that way so that we can love others that way too. So I'm going to go ahead and pray. Let you guys go. I have some activities attached there so you can learn a little bit more about Madagascar and you can have some fun things that you can do. And I hope you guys have a great week and I'll see you again on Sunday. Lord, thank you so much for this day. Thank you for the time that we've been able to spend together, Lord. I thank you for books about kids learning about what it's like to be a missionary, Lord. How their families are setting examples for them, but how they also get to learn about different cultures, how you made people differently, and how you love them dearly, and everybody is to know about who you are, Lord. Thank you for friendships and for people that you find in what would appear to be unlikely places, Lord, but because you created all of us, we can find family wherever we go. I pray for our friends and our family right now, Lord, and anybody who's watching, that you will just bless them and their time together. And even though we may be in our homes today, Lord, that you will just bless us with your presence, because no matter where we are, you are there. We love you and we thank you so much. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey guys, have a great day. I'll see you later. Bye.